Welcome to The Why Factor, a chance to work out why we do what we do. BBC World Service podcasts are supported by advertising.
Hi, I'm Linda.
And I'm Mercy.
Don't worry, you haven't downloaded the wrong podcast. We're here to tell you about our new podcast.
It's called Parentland, and it deals with problems that sound sort of like this.
Come on, it's bed.
I don't want to go to bed. I want to be an elephant.
That's Parentland, a brand new podcast from the BBC World Service.
And we'll be back at the end of this podcast to tell you a bit more about it.
Thank you for downloading this edition of The Why Factor, the programme that seeks to find out why we do the things we do. I hope you enjoy it.
Okay, 3, 2, 1.
You.
Oh, no. What is this?
Oh, my.
When he's like,
it is just another Saturday at Choi Hung, a social housing estate in Hong Kong. Its name means rainbow in Cantonese, and its pastel-coloured facades have become an international Instagram sensation.
In this direction, you'll see here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 20, 30 couples. People who are just here to take the pictures for Instagram.
I'm not so ashamed that I wanted to come to some building and take a picture because there are so many people doing the same thing.
Hundreds of visitors gather to photograph the brightly coloured basketball court, which complements the yellows, oranges and blues on the blocks behind it.
Before coming here, I looked places with hashtags like Hong Kong, and I saw many pictures with this place.
This is quite a famous spot because of the architecture.
Built in the early 60s, these 11 apartment blocks are now an unlikely tourist attraction. This is The Why Factor on the BBC World Service. I'm Ivana Davidovich, and in this edition we're asking, why is architecture so big on Instagram? And could social media even change the way architects work? Search hashtag architecture on Instagram, and you will return a massive number of results. Architecture publications Design and Arch Daily have more followers than Cosmopolitan and Marie Claire.
Architecture is so popular because it sums up a place like nothing else. It gives that instant kind of snapshot of where you are.
Helen Coffey is a travel writer for The Independent in the UK.
I think there's something about it being man-made as well, that we kind of recognise that sort of humanity that's gone into it, that it wasn't just created, that we created it somehow, and it really captures the imagination.
It's probably the platform that shows architecture the best.
Australian architect Scott Valentine lives in Bali in Indonesia. He's written an Instagram design guide for architects.
You could almost say it's democratised architecture and brought it down to people who can sort of interact with it. They can be a part of it in one way or another. And something we notice, because we're in Bali a lot, is that we find a lot of the travellers these days, especially the younger travellers, will pick their holiday based on what's happening on their Instagram feed.
London architect Carl Turner believes that architecture is popular on Instagram because it encourages people to focus on the details in the buildings.
People look at quirky things like rainwater pipes, door handles or, you know, street numbers. And there's all these kind of weird collection things going on Instagram. And I think it's making people much more aware of the design of cities and buildings.
There's no part of the city that doesn't have some sort of houses that have fallen into disrepair. And I wanted to capture that.
Damond Meek is from St. Louis, Missouri, in the United States. He started his own collection on Instagram called Slum Beautiful. His images, although not of conventionally pretty and polished buildings, quickly picked up followers from all across the world, particularly after his Instagram account had been featured in a UK newspaper. His images show dilapidated, largely solitary brick houses sitting lonesome on their individual plots. Colours are deep and prominent, reds, blues and oranges. Damond gives them a highly saturated, sometimes haunting look.
I just felt like those buildings had a lot of character in their current state. You know, they still had a regalness to them, and even some dignity and stoicism.
Although he's a commercial photographer with all the kit imaginable, DeMond found the immediacy of Instagram liberating.
It started when I was at a slow point in my career. Around that time, there was some depression going on. There was a lot of boredom. So one day, I just started driving around town, trying to gather my thoughts. And I was sitting in front of this old home, and I just decided to take a picture of it on my phone and just uploaded it to Instagram and didn't think anything of it. That's what I did every day for a couple of months. Instagram, it provided me like a therapeutic space to creatively get out of a rut. You know, instead of waiting around and constantly getting caught up in the rat race of commercial advertising and making sales and visiting agencies, you know, I had another outlet to do something creative.
It's not just photographers and enthusiasts who like the app. Architects use it to show what they're up to.
Instagram, it's all about a new form of storytelling.
Ippolito Pestellini-Laparelli is an architect with Rem Koolhaas's International Practice Office of Metropolitan Architecture. Their Instagram account has more than 300,000 followers.
What is really increasingly important for us is to give a sense of the process, what is behind the scenes. We produce buildings, but instead of normally publish pictures, which are empty and beautiful and monumental and sculptural and so on, normally we repost pictures from the users of those buildings. It's in a way about reversing the perspective. Instead of projecting the image that we have about ourselves, we're sort of gathering here and there the image that other people have of our buildings. And often architecture is only the background of a very messy desk, of people talking, and it's fine. You know, it's more about the life that happens within buildings than the dramatic shot of a cantilever or a structure. And I really like that because at the end, the building disappears to actually serve its purpose.
But when you see those Instagram pictures of people in buildings, it's more often than not a selfie. So I wonder if Instagram is actually more about our own narcissism than architecture.
The metrics show that it's much more popular if you have a person in the picture than if you just take a picture of a building. And so it becomes all about you and your story and your experience. I think it's really sad the way it's changed how we consume places.
Can you guys help me pick a filter? I don't know if I should go with XX Pro or Valencia. I want to look tan. What should my caption be? I want it to be clever. How about living with my ladies? Hashtag live. I only got 10 likes in the last 5 minutes. Do you think I should take it down? Let me take another selfie.
Last summer I went to Lisbon, and they'd put up outside the Lisbon Museum a temporary wall that was covered in these really brightly coloured fake flowers. Obviously fake flowers in lots of colours, like catnip to Instagrammers. And they're just sort of built up this queue of people steadily growing who are waiting patiently for their turn to go and stand in front of the wall and get a selfie. And what I really noticed about that was they would get this picture and then not a single one of them went in the museum.
Jason just liked my selfie. What a creep. Is that guy sleeping over there? Yeah, the one next to the girl with no shoes on. That's so ratchet. That girl is such a...
So, if people like sharing images of architecture on Instagram, and architects like seeing their work shared there, could they start designing buildings to be Instagrammable? Scott Valentine says yes, because increasingly that's what clients are asking for. He's based in Bali, one of the most Instagram places in the world, where it can be really hard to stand out.
It was actually in a lot of the initial client meetings we would have with people. They kept asking for, we need to be in the top 9 tiles of Instagram. We want to be found on Instagram easy. We want everyone to be coming to us because of Instagram. So using Instagram as a design tool, we can see how people react to spaces and use that to inform a design and create design strategies for architecture, interior design, branding, everything. It all comes together to create the end product. We can look through people's accounts and see what they're taking photos of, what they're finding remarkable, and then have that influence the bare bones of the building or the interior design or any part of the building that people are responding to. I think people maybe should stop thinking of it as an app and start thinking of it as a massive database of pictures that show the way people feel about space and places.
Hello. Hey, I'm Ivana. Very nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
In Peckham in South London, I meet architect Carl Turner outside of an old supermarket car park, which his company has turned into a multi-use community space, a mixture of affordable workspaces, music venues, restaurants and bars.
Peckham Levels. I can see a sign. I think we have to turn left,
yes,
don't we?
Excellent. We do.
So we're just walking down this sort of alleyway. There's graffiti everywhere.
Yeah, looks a bit brutal and a bit kind of rough on the outside.
It does.
Yeah, it's a kind of rough around the edges kind of urban space.
So we've just come inside from the alleyway.
Yeah.
So we have steps,
yeah,
kind of colourful steps going downwards. They're all yellow. Upwards, they're sort of orange and pink and all sorts of colours.
Yeah. You know, I think it's kind of unexpectedly almost become possibly one of the most Instagrammed things that you'll ever see.
Yeah.
And you see the little mirrors in the corners. So
yes.
Those are some of the favourite places for people to...
Photograph themselves.
So many people walk up this staircase. There are lifts, but people tend not to use them.
Because they want to take photos of themselves in these mirrors, of course.
Designing with Instagram in mind was definitely part of the brief for Peckham Levels. And I guess, as architects, we're kind of slightly nervous about that, to say the least, because we believe in sort of quiet background architecture, but that's not going to feature on Instagram. I think the reason that it works here is because these are internal elements. Most of it's kind of paint finishes and colours. We realise it's really important to capture the imagination, particularly of a young audience that we're trying to bring out to this kind of spot. So we're very aware that people like sharing moments of their life where they're having a great time, they're partying. And the reason that somebody's going to take a picture of themselves is because they want to stand in something that's kind of memorable. So that's why you need those kind of Instagram moments.
Right, so we've changed colours as we're walking up the stairs from pinks to greens and blues.
Yeah.
And now we are on level 5, is that right?
Yeah, no? We're on level 5, which is the bottom half of the main public floors.
Wow.
Yeah.
So you can see the ramp, is it? Well, this is where the cars used to go up.
Yeah, exactly. We've taken out a section of wall here and put these really big, colourful steps. And then it winds around to the big food space, so there's 7 food kiosks along there. Some bars.
Restaurants there as well, aren't there?
There's a vegan restaurant by day, jazz bar by night, of course.
So financially, making it popular on social media has paid off, hasn't it?
Yeah, indeed. And some studies have been carried out by the councils to measure the impact on the local economy. Bot Brixton is basically a sort of multi-purpose space created from shipping containers. Peckham Levels is a much bigger project. So they have similar kind of programmes in terms of what happens in the spaces, but they're two different types of space we've created. The council carried out an independent survey and they found that people were spending roughly £10 million a year outside of Pot Brixton. So, you know, I think for every £2 spent at Pot Brixton, another £1 was being spent in other businesses.
Do you expect that means that in the future, very near future, more and more clients will be from the get up and go demanding from architects to think about how something is going to look on Instagram?
Yeah, I do believe that it will start to become an intrinsic brief for a lot of buildings, but it's a worrying trend if they're thinking about the whole building being an Instagram moment. Yeah, if buildings become billboards, we're in kind of serious dangerous territory, you know.
So your experiences with Instagram and your followers, has that informed the way you and your company design certain buildings?
No.
Architect Ippolito Pestellini Laparelli again.
It's a question, though, that we get from clients. Like, this building or this event needs to look good on Instagram.
That was my next question.
Yeah,
because
yeah.
you can have ideas, but there are people who put money, they commission you, and what do they say?
It is becoming something that we need to address somehow, but I don't think that really changed in the past 40 years. You know, clients approached big architectural firm to have a public representation, no? To basically build a building, design a public square or whatever, and that sort of says something about them. It's just that, of course, every client now has an Instagram account, so they like to have a good building that they can take pictures of.
So if it's always been the same since we've had photography and people wanted to publicize their buildings, then how has Instagram changed anything at all?
Let's say the work that we do reaches more quickly a wider audience. We can interact with them. We can mobilize their vote for public voting, for example. You know, sometimes competitions are, they ask for a public vote. That's something that is becoming quite common.
Philipp Ursprung is an art and architecture historian at ETH University in Switzerland.
One is looking for majorities. One is trying to evade conflict. One try to minimize difference. That's, of course, also what the social media do. They allow to test reactions before it comes to a confrontation. Okay, if many people like it, I'm probably going to go in this direction. If less people like it, I won't. That's the way cities also are kind of furnished today. One tries to plan for places of encounter, for places of special attraction, as if the city would be a stage, a theater.
Instagram is changing the way that we think about buildings, and yeah, it's definitely thinking about what the building's facades look like, their colours, the materials they're clad in.
Architect Carl Turner.
It's just weird how Instagram has kind of fueled this one particular thing I can think of, which is the resurgence of particularly round topped arches rather than kind of pointed Gothic arches. But probably people have been wanting to do things for years and they've been thinking, oh, I can't use that particular motif or type of thing. And then it starts appearing on Instagram. Probably from some architects overseas working with arches, particularly in Japan. Arches started to appear maybe 5 years ago. And now pretty much every image I see is just kind of colonnades and arches and the resurgence of circular windows. You know, it's these kind of very, very decorative elements that look great on drawings. Whether they make really great buildings is a kind of question of taste. I think Instagram is kind of somehow fueling that kind of need for some big kind of signature piece. It's called the Bilbao effect, and that was Frank Gehry's Guggenheim Museum in Bilbao, which was, you know, a signature building that really transformed quite a sleepy northern Spanish city into a kind of global destination with people flocking there just to see the building. So now everybody wants a Guggenheim gallery to bring tourism and to bring people, but obviously we can't design cities full of Guggenheim galleries that are kind of, you know, kind of individual buildings.
The Bilbao effect attracts visitors and money. Bilbao's iconic Guggenheim Museum was opened in 1997, when Instagram was still a twinkle in Silicon Valley's eye. But social media has accelerated the effect, and now even megacities like New York, already full of landmark buildings, want more. In March 2019, a structure called The Vessel will be open to the public, created by British designer Thomas Heatherwick, with an elaborate staircase leading to nowhere and polished copper balconies, Vessel is certainly Instagrammable. Stephen Ross, the billionaire property magnate who commissioned it, says he wanted an iconic bauble that would become a tourist magnet. But the Bilbao effect is even more prominent in new cities in the Gulf and the Far East, according to Philipp Ursprung.
I was just now in a new performing arts centre near Beijing, which seemed to come out of an Instagram fantasy, and it is intended to make this area more attractive. But it's completely over-dimensioned, so it takes about half an hour to walk through it. The stairs, the circulation, the plazas are so huge that one is completely lost. I'm sure that on a rendering or on a small screen, it looks quite amazing. but when you walk through it, it falls apart. Dubai was in a way disappointing. I was, of course, expecting this image that I had to materialize. Being on top of the Burj Khalifa, the tallest building of the world, to look down is a beautiful image, but much of the time that you then spend in elevators and escalators and in malls is completely disorienting and close to what Rem Koolhaas calls junk space.
Philip says in some ways, none of this is new. There has always been a close relationship between architecture and photography.
The sympathy, the affinity between photography and architecture is very old. The relationship goes back all the way to the beginning of photography. This is in the 1820s, 1830s. There is a particular affinity between the spaces or the style, the aesthetics of architecture and the camera as a machine.
But for young aspiring architects, Instagram is a huge part of life. And for them, the instinct to create images which work on it is hardwired. But Ippolito Pestellini-Laparelli, who teaches at the Royal College of Arts in London, has his doubts.
Even in my studio here at the Royal College of Arts, you know, every studio, every module has its own Instagram account. Every studio basically takes it very seriously. It becomes a form of representation of the studio, of the research that we do, of the experiences that we do, of the field trips and so on. It seems that you don't exist unless you got a sort of well-curated Instagram account. But it should not become a cage. And people should actually really think that they exist far beyond, you know, their Instagram account. What I'm noticing, though, is that especially with younger people, there is less traction. I'm starting to get in the past 2 years comments like, okay, we are tired, you know, to actually always be connected. We are tired, actually, to always be online. We are tired to be obliged to say what we like, what we do, where we go, and so on. So I don't know. There might be suddenly a moment of liberation from all these platforms, and something else will come up, for sure.
There is no problem with Instagram helping to fuel interest in our built environment. But it would be a problem if the pursuit of superficial visual appeal changed the design of our cities for the worse. That might sound a bit far-fetched, but architect Carl Turner isn't so sure.
I think there's a whole debate at the moment about decoration, colour. A new language is emerging with influences from graphic design and fashion. So it's about applied textures and surfaces and decoration, because we're moving into an image-led society where there's a new generation of designers coming through who've grown up with social media and Instagram, and, yeah, they're questioning this idea of form follows function and functionality. I think that's quite interesting that sort of fascism of modernism has definitely been challenged by Instagram.
This edition of The Y Factor was presented by me, Ivana Davidovic. It was produced by Rose Delarabiti, and our sound engineer was Graham Puddyfoot. Our editor is Richard Knight. We'd love to hear your ideas for future episodes. Do write to us at yfactor@bbc.com.
Hi, I'm Linda.
And I'm Mercy.
And we're the presenters of a brand new podcast from the BBC World Service called
Parentland.
The podcast is going to be taking your questions and addressing them through the lens of scientific evidence and culture.
Based on some of the emails we've had so far, we're going to be tackling a whole range of issues from like babies through to teenagers, looking at things like good and bad screen time,
intelligence,
bedwetting,
multilingualism,
and many, many more.
In the first episode, we're going to be looking at discipline.
How to get your kid to do what you actually want them to do rather than what they want to do.
That episode is available right now by searching for Parentland wherever you found this podcast.
So see you soon
in Parentland.